to Muse Participate. My name is Antoine Mentor with Live FM and Muse Africa.
And my name is Akosia Hansen with YFM. Now, this year, we're going to the polls again to elect new leaders for our country. Now, they say we as youth, we don't really care about this stuff. All we care about is the movies, series
social
life. Now.
Yeah, series. Life. Talking about series. Mm. I'm really looking forward to YOLO.
Game of Thrones. We're still on Game of Thrones.
It's all about series.
Okay, now back to serious business. We actually want to discuss the issues that we think politicians should focus on during this election season. So we've got an amazing panel here to talk about that.
That's what this platform was for. Muse Participate. We want to have an open discussion, find out what the young folks are looking out for, what's going to inform our decision to participate in this year's election. People say we go for the cards, but we never actually vote. We say this year is different. Right, guys?
Yeah.
Awesome. So this platform was put together by Muse Africa in collaboration with Oxfam in Ghana with support from Rave Media Group, Impact Hub, and the BBG Group. This is a Muse Unite production. Thank you guys so much for joining us wherever you are.
And you can actually join in the conversation online on Twitter. It's at Muse_Africa. Facebook, Snapchat, and Instagram, it's Muse Africa.
We're going to begin with, our guests here. We have a panel, a three-member panel, really interesting, bright, young group of people. But before we get to them, we're going to hit the streets and find out what people have to say about what's going to inform their decision come December 2016.
Before I vote for any candidate in this year's presidential or parliamentary elections, I'll consider someone who will create jobs for the youth. As you already know, the youth unemployment is at its highest peak, and a lot of people are graduates, they are not getting jobs to do. And before I vote for anyone in this year's elections, I consider that as a paramount reason for voting.
When a candidate can provide a country with an infrastructure, we the youth, we can get something doing.
The key issues that will inform my decision in voting for a candidate is the issue of youth unemployment. The youth constitute a chunk majority of the population in Ghana. But youth unemployment is something that most governments try to curb, but were not able to. So a candidate who will tackle this particular area will be my ideal choice of candidate, which I'll be grateful or I'll be willing to vote for.
As for me, I'll focus more on a candidate who speaks more of evaluation. The country right now, there are a lot of candidates saying things, making promises, but when they come to power, there's no evaluation in control. You can see that many of them, mostly this present government, many of their constituencies, they are just, the only thing you can think about is that the power, like, they just embezzle the money because nobody is evaluating.
Welcome back. So those are some of the views we got from the streets, people sharing ideas of the issues they feel people should talk about during this election period. And we actually have some young politicians right here who are going to be listening to us and probably take those notes upstairs. I have to recognize Jerian Ponsa of the NPP, Aziz Gomda of the CPP, Felix Mante of PPP, and Kadir Abdul Rauf Issa, and thank you guys so much for being here. But let's go straight to our millennials. My first question to you is to ask you, what issues do you wish politicians will focus on during this election period, and make it brief and as specific as possible? Let me start with Benjamin right there.
Thank you. I'm Benjamin. I'm looking out for someone who is going to give out policies for youth empowerment.
Okay.
Because the youth in the country are the future for the country. So if given that platform and the room to operate freely, I think it's going to help the country in the near future. So I want a government that will be able to have policies that the youth will be able to work on. Like, I'm going to this place, this organization, and I know my problems will be solved for me. Mm. I want a government who's going to address that for me specifically.
All right, so the creative industry, address it creatively, all right? And I would like to turn to you. Can you tell us your name first, please?
My name is Angela. And there are so many challenges we are facing as a country right now that need critical attention, okay? But my personal issue is on youth unemployment. We are sent to the university to read courses. We go through a four-year program. We come out and we don't know what to do. There's no job on the market for us. And as if that is not enough, we are posted dealing with the things that we are being sent there to do.
Okay.
So if any presidential candidate is listening to me, I want you to concentrate more on youth unemployment.
I think they're actually taking notes here, so big ups to you. Please keep it brief for me. Let me know what you feel people should focus on during this period.
My name is Josh. Okay, I think it's about time politicians give us a new picture of what they are really about, a new profile, because from what I have observed, they are so much into attacking each other and criticizing themselves all the time. I think they should focus on their promises and then their agendas instead of wasting so much time on, you know, attacking themselves and radio and all of that.
I'd love to hear from some of them.
Yeah, great input from over there. Let's come here. I've got three gentlemen. You guys are voting, right?
Yeah.
Definitely. What are you voting for? Like, what's the one thing that's going to inform your decision when it comes to voting?
Well, I'm Justice Dadzie. And then I would want a president who will protect the public purse and then get people on the ground, or whatever the president or the government will do to get the first-hand information in order to invest rightly. That's all I want.
I like that, man. In order to invest right, prioritize, all right? Okay, so one final comment. What informs your decision?
Okay, my name is Ali Maiga, and what I would like to see from our leaders is I want a collective item. Like, they should also look upon the other sectors. I mean, all the sectors. They shouldn't look at one side saying this and that, they are fought over here and there. So looking at them will really build Ghana and also enjoy as youth.
So you want collective development?
Yeah.
All right, so we've heard from our millennials, you know, very important inputs right there. But it's about time we proper introduce, our guest panel and find out what informs their decisions. So I'm going to start off. We have a three-member panel today. One of them is a musician. You've probably seen him all over TV. You've probably attended his concerts, and I can guarantee you have his music on your playlist. All right, but let me introduce the lady first off. Her name is Jemila Abdulai. She's a development finance specialist, a blogger, and a founder of the circumspect.com website. Circumspect.com. Check it out right now. It's a digital platform dedicated to capturing meaningful insights, spurring interaction, and inspiring creative action amongst us, the young creative Africans. Next on our list, DerryDean Dadzie. He was awarded the Young Entrepreneur of the Year in 2011 by Waves International. All right, DerryDean is the co-founder and CEO of a Ghanaian internet and mobile software service company. It's called Dream Oval. You've probably heard of it about it before. Now, in the past few years, this company has helped different corporations utilize the internet and mobile softwares and other devices in everyday activities, you know, from payments, banking, and health delivery. Finally, we've got the man EL, the musician I was telling you about. You know him. You've heard about him. He's an award-winning musician, co-founder and president of BBNZ Live, the music division. He's very well awarded. Recently, he won the Artist of the Year at the VGMA's 2016. That's our three-member panel. A round of applause for them. Yes. So we're going to start off with you, Jemila. You've been out of the country. You studied abroad. You were in countries where the youth were put into focus and prioritized. Now you're here. You've worked at Development Bank. You've worked with many young people. You blog. What should we, the youth, be looking out for before we go out to vote?
Yeah. Well, I think as someone coming from an economics background, I think that it's really imperative that we look at the economy, because as many people have mentioned different things, but I think it's the economy that ties it all together, right? So if you're talking about healthcare, that affects workers, that affects employment, and that affects production, trade, and so on. I think at the moment that we're in Ghana right now, we really need decisive leadership. We need leaders who will be willing to go to the drawing board and map out what are our strengths, what are the areas that we could do better in, and how do we leverage that to improve the lives of people? Because at the end of the day, it's not just policy. The policies affect people.
Yeah.
If I'm going to talk about specifics, education is big on my list. I went to school in Ghana, yes, up until high school, but for college, I went abroad. And a lot of the things that now I could say I probably take for granted, for example, career development. There's a career development agency at the University of Ghana, but it's not active. And if those students had that, then the issues about unemployment and being employable, having the skills to actually do the work, would probably be addressed. I think we need to look at our curriculum. We need a leader who will be willing to take those hard decisions, look at the curriculum and see what skills are needed, what skills are needed to not just move us to the next 4 years, but maybe the next 10, 20 years. Mm. Linked to that is energy. I visited Paris some years back, and we went up to the Eiffel Tower and we're looking down on the city. And it was very interesting to see what kind of framework they had. It actually looked like a key, and then it was circular. So everything was connected, all the grids were connected. And you could see that this was something that somebody sat down and thought about. And they not just thought about the Eiffel Tower, which is where most people tend to go, but they thought about, if we're expanding, how are we going to continuously connect it? So we shouldn't just be thinking about today. And it should be less politics, as the young gentleman over there mentioned, less politics, and realize that it is leadership and you're affecting people's lives. And we cannot just be depending on the things that Kwame Nkrumah puts into place, because obviously we're not the same people. We've grown, a lot has changed, it's different times. So tied to all of that technology, I think we really need to, you know, look forward.
You've raised like a whole range of issues.
Yeah, three major things. Education.
I also have a question about comparing Ghana to other countries. I'm not too big on that, but we'll throw that debate out later. But I want to hear from our man EL. We want to know.
Elom,
you know? Yeah. We want to know what issues.
Sorry, go ahead.
Would you?
Antoine.
I'm just giving all his AKAs. No,
continue. No, be
no
done.
This is fine.
You're done?
Coco Master. No, I'm done. That's my last one.
So, Al, we want to know what issues you feel that government should actually focus on during this period, especially you being in the music industry, being a key figure in that. What support do you think government needs to, and politicians should actually be talking about when it comes to the creative industry?
Kosia, thank you so much. Thank you for having me on the show as well.
Welcome.
Awesome platform. I speak in a creative capacity for all who represent or work in the creative industry. And whether you be a kente weaver or you are a painter or a musician, creativity just appeals to me a lot. So that's how come I work in the sector in which I do. I think for the creative person, what we really want in our whole lives is to be able to get the opportunity to do our work, to create, to be able to create and show that work to the people who matter, to our target audience, to our target market, and even wider than that, and be able to feed our families, to get remuneration from that. And I think that is what every creative person strives towards, to achieve. And I think to be able to make these things happen, changes have to be made. For every development to happen, we're always talking about want to develop this and change. We need to change. And for things to happen and for things to go along.
What specific change do you want to see?
Two things I would consider if I was in a politician's shoes or if I was running for election. Two things. I always approach my projects in a short-term, medium, and a long-term fashion. Short-term, there are things like copyright. Things like royalties, collection of royalties, there are things like licensing. These things exist in our market, in our industry, in little ways, but you know, they are not consolidated and they have not been solidified. And I think once we're able to do that, solidify these things and make sure that they work in full capacity, that is when we have created a fully functional industry. And I think that goes a long way to serve all these creative people who have so much to offer. I think it's also a very good way to generate taxes, which go back to the government. And so it's a revolving door, and it's something that I think we should really look at. Also, let's jump to long term because of, conversation sake. My sister here mentioned education. It's something that keeps on coming. My brother also there said the same thing. I think when your child comes to you and says, I want to be a musician, it's slightly frowned upon.
Slightly.
I went through a lot because I had my machine seized from me by my parents. Look, steady, politics.
Wow.
So it's very hard for us to let our children go in that path because we all have our talents. That gentleman there is an actor and he's having a very difficult time being able to find support to do what he loves to do. So I think education, injecting creative arts even more and more into our educational system will go a very long way. We can learn programming. I don't know about one university in Ghana here that teaches or, has a course on programming or specifically or composition, music composition and stuff like that. I haven't seen it. I haven't experienced it for myself. So I think stuff like that needs to be looked at. Also, recreational facilities.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have venues. We have two solid venues in this country.
That's it.
That's it. I want to do a show and accommodate 1,000 people. I know where to go. But if I want to accommodate 10,000 people, it begins to begin a little bit challenging, you know? So it becomes challenging. So I think these are also some things that I should look at. And also, you say you don't like to compare Ghana to other countries, but you should. Because it's not like you're plagiarizing or copying them, but just so that you know at the level at which you operate. Somebody once asked me, what is the size of our music industry? I was dumbfounded. I have no answer for that. You know, so looking at these things, I think you take Nigeria, for example. They don't just play any song on their radio stations. But Ghana, we play every Nigerian song that comes out. So I think there should be a little bit more regulation when it comes to what we hear on radio, how we support our own music industry, and how we protect our boundaries. And I think these things, just these things, and a few more can go away.
Education, support structure, and regulation. I like that.
We shouldn't always feel bad about what our progress in Ghana because of colonialism. We have a history. There's a reason why we're here. That's why I say I don't like comparing too much with the bigger powers because there's a reason why Ghana is where it is today.
Gotcha.
But yeah.
All right. Moving to our final panel member. Derry, you're a businessman. You started your own company. I know so many people actually started their companies, but they had to, you know, shut down at some point, especially because of the power crisis. They couldn't survive it. But you're here now. So as a gentleman, as a businessman, as a young person, what's going to inform your decision to vote this time around?
So when it comes to our politics and or national development, I see from a point of view that is the private sector that is going to drive it. I don't believe that government is responsible for doing the things that everybody thinks that they have to do. So let's say creation of jobs. I think that the private sector can create the jobs. The government's role is to create the conditions that will enable the private sector or the private person like you and I, what is sitting here, to be able to become productive and create more jobs. So that is what I'll be looking at. The person who is actually looking at creating the conditions, the infrastructure, the policies, the taxes, you know, the rebate that will enable me thrive as a businessman, that will create opportunities for me beyond Ghana, you know, to be able to thrive. Because what I see is that there's so much bread and butter conversations in our politics. Everything is about what you eat and how we survive, and then that's why there's so much corruption, because everybody comes and looks for bread and butter. The mindset is so myopic, it's so short term. We're not looking at the long term. I'm looking at audacity. Which person is speaking for the next 100 years or the next 50 years? Which person is speaking for us to have a Singapore? Not just giving me something like a pound or something, you know, just for the day for me to get my vote in and go away. So I'm looking at those kind of things, the economy, right? The person who wants to not just come and put up things, just come and put up things because that's what I did. You know, what we do is that our benchmarking is based on pictures. The things that we see with our eyes. But there are other things that happen in the economy that you don't see with your eyes, but enables individuals to thrive, to become self-empowered, and for them to take their destiny into their own hands. What is happening in our politics is that we're having a politics that's making people depend too much on government. So we're having these political gods and laws who feel so powerful, and we are always succumbing to them. We need to twist it down. We need to turn it around and give the power to the people. And, you know,
thank you very much.
You know, we need to give the power to the people. And for me, that is very important. The government is responsible for the social things, like creating a healthcare system that can let everybody afford healthcare. If you travel, if you go to London, I've traveled and had cheaper healthcare and more quality than I would have had in Ghana. I paid £13 for my eye, where I paid 300 Ghana cedis for just the check, right? So that tells you a system that is thriving on the private sector, but that has social, you know, dynamic to let the individuals, the kayaye, you know, the people that who cannot afford to afford. We need to make it possible for people to pick the right transport. In Ghana, if you have money, you get some nice ride to sit in.
you can do an Uber if you have money. Yeah. But if you travel elsewhere in the world, it doesn't matter who you are. You don't have to have money to be in an Uber. Mm. Or you don't have to have money to be in the poshest train. Mm. In Ghana, there's so much discrimination because there's this big gap between the rich and the poor. The government is supposed to bridge that gap. Then that gap can be bridged with a lot of good policies. Mm. And they have to empower the private sector to create jobs so everybody can get a job. You don't have to look prim and proper to get a job. Mm. Everybody, whether you are disabled, whether you can see, whether you can't think far, however you...
I'm actually glad you raised that. Inclusivity is one thing. Yeah. Disability is another key issue. Yeah. I think we'll definitely pick that up, but let's go on a quick break. When we come back, it's more of this good stuff. Election year again.
So you know how difficult it is to vote in other countries, right?
In other countries, people are not allowed to vote when they are 18.
But thankfully in Ghana, you just have to be 18 and you can vote. And that's so cool.
It is our time to vote.
And together with Muse Africa, we urge you to vote.
I urge you all to vote.
Remember, your vote is your right.
Your vote is your power.
Participate.
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 Participate. Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Participate is a project by Muse Africa in collaboration with Oxfam in Ghana, Friends of the Nation, and the Ray Media Group.
Muse Africa has always been about representing the voice of young Africans and Ghanaians. In the build-up to the 2016 general elections in Ghana, and with support from Oxfam in Ghana and Friends of the Nation, we gathered a group of young Ghanaians to have a sit-down and a one-on-one discussion with the presidential candidates of the Convention People's Party, the great CPP, Ivor Kwabena Greenstreet, to engage him on policies and plans for Ghanaian youth in relation to education, jobs, creative arts, culture, and technology.
What kind of music do you listen to?
I like Stoneboy a bit.
Oh, okay.
His song, what is it? Higher, higher.
Go high, yeah, Stoneboy, yeah. Okay.
There are still countries around the world where people can choose their leaders.
As a Ghanaian, when you turn 18,
meet me a vote to choose a leader.
You have the power to shape the direction of your country by going to the polls in December.
And that's real power.
That's real power.
Now that's real power.
My name is Manifest.
My name is Adam, go get him.
My name is Ms. V.
My name is Tina So.
Dijome Kabum the Cherish.
My name is Zil, VVIP, and together with Muse Africa
and Oxfam in Ghana,
I want you to know
it doesn't matter what side you're on.
You can vote to make a difference.
Your vote makes a difference.
Your vote still makes a difference.
So participate.
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 If you do election, I'm sure go outside, go vote.
Choose or lose.
Participate is a project by Muse Africa in collaboration with Oxfam in Ghana, the Ray Media Group, and Friends of the Nation.
Welcome back. If you just joined, this is Muse Participate, the Millennial Panel of the Participate campaign, brought to you by Muse Africa and Oxfam in Ghana, with support from the Rave Media Group, Impact Hub, and the BBG Group. This is a Muse Unite production. Unite is a youth experiential and activation arm of Muse Media Networks. We will read some of the submissions and perspectives that you guys shared on social media with us. But before that, I'd like you guys to meet the man behind this initiative, the man behind this campaign. We're going to welcome the man, Sadiq, on stage of Muse Africa. Thanks. All right, now Sadiq is the CEO and co-founder of Muse Africa. Sadiq, welcome.
Thanks.
To your very own show. Now tell me, man, how did this all start for you? Muse participates. Are you into politics yourself? Like, what informed this whole decision here?
All right, so Muse generally is a music and a lifestyle brand with our TV properties on TV, museafrica.com, and our experiential event. This year, we wanted to do something different. I said the fact that we are not only about music, entertainment, and lifestyle, we also wanted to positively impact on our audience, the millennial audience. And so after we realized that most of our millennial audience don't necessarily take part in elections, they will either register, have the cards, and not take part in elections, we sought out to create a campaign that will encourage them to take part in the elections. And that's how Come Participate came about. And so when we came out with it and then sat down with Oxfam also bought into it, and so that's how come we're able to bring this campaign.
Awesome. Are you happy with the results so far?
I'm excited about how it's turning out. For the first time, we're having the first TV town hall show, for a millennial audience, which is very good. There are a number of things we'll be doing. Okay. The audience should look out for a new song that's going to come, a campaign song. There's going to be a video out of that as well. Aside from that, as well, we're going to have one-on-one interactive sessions with the presidential candidates, where we're going to choose a number of young individuals to have interactive sessions with the presidential candidates. That's another first as well. So we're excited about the fact that this is innovative. This has never been done before, and we're breaking new grounds with this campaign.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Sadiq.
Thank you very much.
That's Sadiq Abubakar, CEO and co-founder of Muse Africa. The big question we're asking today is, why should we vote? We're going to find out from people across the country, Tamale and straight up to Kumasi, why they, the youth in those areas, have decided to vote, or what they are going to vote about. Let's check that out right now. Akos.
All right, so let's actually start with our social media comments. A couple have come in. I just want to do that. This message says, talking about inclusivity, I want to know how this government is going to make our society friendly and more accessible to persons with disability. That's a great question. Another comment comes in, says, I love EL's submission on copywriting. The arts are seen as dondology in Ghana. Now, without much ado, let's check out Ebenezer Nanaya Odonko, who is also known as NYDJ, the morning show host of YFM Kumasi. He's going to be telling us what the streets are saying in Kumasi. Check this out.
Thank you very much for having me on the Muse Millennial Panel. It's such a great thing to be here today to talk to the world and to talk to Ghana, to know exactly what's going on coming up with elections 2016. Now, there's this question as to what are the key issues young people in the Kumasi or Ashanti region, where I am, actually focusing on with regards to those elections. Now, as general, it's something basic that everybody, every Ghanaian youth is looking out for. It's not different from what Accra or Takoradi is looking out for. The youth in Ashanti region are looking out for quality education, they are looking out for health, they are looking out for jobs and how they will be able to get all the jobs when they are done with school. These are some of the things that occupy their thoughts and their minds as they look up to election 2016 as to who is bringing in some of these ideas and some of these policies that will really benefit them. Because to them, if these things are non-existent, then their future is kind of shady. So these are some of the things that the Ghanaian youth, or should I say the youth in the Ashanti region where I operate, are looking forward to with these politicians and as we approach elections 2016. Now, the millennial attitude towards the elections, I can say, in as much as some of them still feel like, okay, well, I have my ID, but I don't really see the essence to go and vote, because why should I just go join a whole queue for like a whole day just to vote for one person? In as much as that opinion is there, there are others who also feel that if you don't vote, then you don't even have any say in talking about whoever becomes the leader of your country. So most of them are getting ready. You see people hold their IDs, and you see social media, how they comment about things when things do not go right. They look at it and they're like, okay, I just picked my ID and this is what is happening. So the millennial youth in Kumasi is really looking forward to this 2016 election and hoping that things go well. And as I said earlier, all they are looking forward to is a peaceful election. They are looking forward to somebody who is coming with education, somebody who is coming in with youth oriented stuff. And hey, why should I forget? Most of them are also looking at entertainment facilities. Kumasi is kind of dry, trust me. So most of them are looking at who has that kind of thing in mind to make sure that after all the stress and all that, they can actually have a place to relax and all that. So this is another thing they are also looking forward to. And they are looking at a system where those who could graduate or come out of the various campuses can also start their own businesses, entrepreneurship. It becomes tough for them. So they are looking at situations, who is going to make the system easy for that young guy who just graduated to be able to get a job or do his own job, set up his own business and keep it running. These are some of the things that youth in Kumasi is looking forward to as we approach elections 2016.
That's the man, NYDJ, radio presenter and blogger with YFM Kumasi. Now let's cross over into Tamale, the northern part of this country. The man, Nash Idi, is a blogger and radio presenter up in the north as well. Let's find out from him what the young political aspirants and the youth in general in Tamale are looking out for in our politicians this year.
Thank you so much, Antoine, for connecting with me all the way from the northern regional capital, Tamale. I think you got it right and you spoke almost like a native speaker. It is true, in Dagbanle, when someone says Kawula, it basically means what's up, and you respond by saying Alafi. So when I meet you on the streets of Tamale and I say Antoine Kawula, you respond by saying what's up. Fast forward to the topic and the discussion for today, the area of job creation and provision of job. We have about 65,000 of Ghanaian youth graduating from the various, you know, tertiary institutions we have in the country, and they basically need jobs, you know. So paramount among the key areas that the youth of this region will want politicians to be talking about in this year's election will be how they will be creating jobs for this, you know, much huge number of, you know, unemployed youth in this country. Secondly, they'll be looking at the area of healthcare, not just healthcare, but provision of affordable quality healthcare to the people of the region, basically. And thirdly, if you ask me, I'll say the area of education is so key among some of the determinants of the youth of this region. If any political party wants the attention of the youth of Northern Region, the party has to be channeling and redirecting their messages towards how the party will handle the issue of education when it is given the nod to handle this country.
That's my man Nash. At least I learned one word, Kaula. That means what's up, right? So that's what people out there are looking out for. He mentioned one thing, education. It seems to be the one thing that's resonating among all our panelists here and the people out there. Now let's hear from our young politicians, the people who want our trust and our vote. Of course, it's going to have a short one-on-one session with them. Let's do
all
this.
All right, so follow me. We have them here, and I'm sure you've heard all the comments that have been passed by the millennials and also by our bloggers and by our expert panel over here. And we want to know what it is you're taking away from this. And is this, are these things you've already started working on, or you're now being eliminated to work on them? I want to start with you, Felix Mate of the PPP.
Yeah, Akusia, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
You look brilliant this afternoon.
I'll dash you the dress.
And it's, you know, the Ghanaian has spoken. That's the youth. Mm. If I say the Ghanaian, because the youth forms 65% and more of the population of Ghana. Mm. And whatever thing that we do affects them directly.
Yeah.
And so if you're a politician, this is the time for you to prove to the ordinary person on the street out there listening to us and watching us that you have something good to offer to them. And so if somebody raises a concern about the economy, he needs to raise it. If somebody raises a concern about employment and then health, education and other things,
mm-hmm.
this is the time. Over the years, you voted and then all these things we have expected that they will be provided to us, but we've not had them.
Mm.
And this is the moment that we are going to use our votes. You out there watching us as a bargaining chip.
But what is your
for
party going to do differently?
For the bargaining chip, we in the PPP,
mm-hmm.
we are for the youth, first of all. And then we represent the entire nation.
Mm-hmm.
And so all our policies, we are practicing total inclusiveness.
Okay.
And we involve the youth, include them in every decision-making process, every position, every level that we take decisions, we involve the youth. So we are designing a youth empowerment program. A youth empowerment program which is not appointing one youth as a minister. And we think we have empowered the youth. A youth empowerment program which we are not going to establish some employment agency which we think we have done that, but it's not sustainable.
Yeah.
We cannot sustain it for somebody to work in that sector for the rest of his life. And so we are targeting the youth by creating jobs. a youth empowerment program where you impart knowledge, skills training, and to the ordinary person, to the youth.
Who else wants to pick up this education topic? Yeah.
Well, thanks very much for the opportunity. My name is Aziz Gomda, and I'm the Deputy Communications Director of the Convention People's Party.
All right.
As a party, we are very committed to empowering the youth and developing the youth. And it is not surprising that when it comes to our manifesto committee, youth was duly represented, and I happen to be the secretary to the manifesto committee. Mm. So I represented a constituency that was very critical to where Ghana wants to be in the near future. And indeed, I engaged with so many people, like-minded people belonging to the bracket youth, or in this context, I would want to describe it, millennials, like you've put it rightly. And before I address the main issue, I'd want to begin from where the panelists ended. And first of all, I would want to begin with Jemila, right?
Can you make it short and sweet?
Yeah,
for
I'll
us?
Make it very
Thank
short.
You.
During her presentations, I think key to her submissions was about the economy.
Yeah.
And to the end, she made a point as though people are not very much interested in what has been done in the past and the issue of Nkrumah and blah blah is in the past. And you see, when you talk about millennials, although there have been difficulty as to where the millennial age ends, but there have been a consensus regarding the baseline.
Mm.
That is from 1980, some say 1990 to 99, others say to 2000.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure almost everybody in this room falls within that category.
Mm.
And throughout the history of the Fourth Republic, it has been either MPP and NDC who have handled Ghana through the 1980s to as we speak now. And I understand the apathy in which we see in the youth. The youth are feeling that, no, there's no need involving in these people. They have messed this country up.
So what are you going to
so
do
what
differently?
We are saying is that this is a dawn of a new era.
Mm-hmm.
Let's bring CPP back. And in bringing CPP back, we have three fundamental ideas that form the bedrock of ideology,
mm-hmm.
which is self-determination. That is believing in the Ghanaian, believing in Ghanaian ingenuity and empowering the Ghanaian to aspire to exactly where they can be to make sure Ghana is better.
Okay.
We also believe in Pan-Africanism, and I want to bring it from the economic perspective. When Derry was speaking, he was talking about market. The combined market of Africa is almost about 1 billion, which is even more than that of EU. But recently, we saw Ghana sign economic partnership agreement with EU, where Ghana stood at a point which was very disadvantaged to Africa in general. As a party that believes in Pan-Africanism, when we come into power, we would empower our youth, create the market, make sure we deal with our African countries where we can have a better bargain. And we're also talking about value addition to products.
Mm-hmm.
We don't believe in importing finished goods. We believe in adding value to whatever we have here. I think we had copyright laws in the past, and that copyright did not envisage we would get to a digital age.
Okay.
Moving forward, what we need to do is to have a revised copyright law that sort of would represent a digital copyright law, like it's practiced somewhere. I think US has a very good way. And if you are a fan of downloading music from Google, when you type, they will say as a result of a complaint, and then what's the name, consonance with the Digital Copyright Act, certain things are taken off. So we'll talk about having a regulatory body that would make sure that people who are suffering so much, putting so much energy in the creative industry, would benefit a lot.
Mm.
And just to end, like Nigeria, for instance, I want to take Nollywood. Nollywood makes averagely about $600 million average to the Nigerian economy. It means things are right. Imagine we having $600 million to our economy every year. I'm sure Dumsa would be a thing of the past. And that is the angle which we would tackle.
Okay.
And I'm sure at the end.
All right. I think I'll take a lady on this panel that I'm sure, EL, if you want to say
convinced?
Anything to this.
That's the big question.
A lady on the panel, most definitely. I need to hear a lady speak. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
My name is Shirley Mason. And my concern is basically about education, because I work with an NGO called Inspiring Youth Achievement, Inspire Ghana. What we do is that we target the communities in the various regions. Now, when we visit those communities, we realize that education there is not as compared to what is in Accra or what is in other places. You know, infrastructure is bad, facilities are not available. Even some teachers, even to the extent of not communicating in English or teaching in English with the students, okay? And it's very discouraging. So if anything could be done, education in those sectors could also be tackled so that we will bridge the gap between education with those advanced and those in the other places too.
All right, okay.
Alrighty, right. So, I mean, again, I asked a question. Are we convinced? Are we? They've
said convinced?
Something.
They spoke really well, though.
A round of applause for them or no? Like, nothing, not yet? Okay, well, the big question we've been asking ourselves is, are we going to vote? Why should we vote? And now I have a gentleman here who wants to make a submission. Let's go ahead.
My name is Jerry Alponson. I'm highly humbled and overwhelmed and also charged with the energy built here. It's quite unfortunate. I mean, so far as we, the youth, we are concerned. I mean, I'm from the NPP. And we have our president, President Mahama, when he was campaigning. I mean, campaigned on the message that he's a youthful guy and should be given the nod. But here you are, he has disappointed the youth.
You represent the NPP, right?
Yes.
Can you tell us what you are going to do differently?
As Felix, his political party is trying to steal from us. We are bringing free universal, and not only that, a quality education.
What does quality education mean?
Education in the sense that we are going to better on what is currently being offered. And if I say quality education, I mean, it cuts across. I mean, whereby facilities and materials are going to be made available. I mean, whereby teachers, I mean, are going to be well paid. I mean, they are going to be well taken off. In other words, going to be well motivated. So that, I mean, they are going to also put up their best in it.
We have submissions, actually.
Yes,
what happened was we went around to find people to actually pledge to vote. Let's check that out. And when we come back, I promise you, we're getting reactions. Kojo Akoto Boateng, you are speaking. So, yes, we will be right back.
It's Muhammad Al-Mahfouz Bashir. I pledge to participate in this year's election. I choose not to lose.
My name is Valerie from Tema. I pledge to participate in this year's election. I choose and not to lose.
My name is Gordon Selassie Dogbe. I pledge to participate in this year's general elections. I will choose and not lose.
My name is Joako Kusi. I pledge to participate in this year's election. I will choose and not lose.
Midindi Justice Dazi. I feel we metu aba eyi di embeso di Ghana so.
My name is Vivian Echimensa. I pledge to vote this year. I choose to win and not to lose.
My name is Vanjima and I pledge to participate in this year's general election. And I pledge to choose and not to
There are still countries around the world where people can choose their leaders.
As a Ghanaian, when you turn 18,
meet me vote choose leader.
You have the power to shape the direction of your country by going to the polls in December.
And that's real power.
That's real power.
Now that's real power.
My name is Manifest.
My name is Adam Go Get 'em.
My name is Ms. V.
My name is Tina So.
This is your homie, Kaboom the Cherish.
My name is Zil, VVIP, and together with Muse Africa
and Oxfam in Ghana,
I want you to know
it doesn't matter what side you're on,
you can vote to make a difference.
Your vote makes a difference.
Your vote still makes a difference.
So participate.
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 It's a true election. I'm sure go outside, go vote.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose.
Participate is a project by Muse Africa in collaboration with Oxfam in Ghana, the Rave Media Group, and Friends of the Nation.
Muse Africa has always been about representing the voice of young Africans and Ghanaians. In the build-up to the 2016 general elections in Ghana, and with support from Oxfam in Ghana and Friends of the Nation, we gathered a group of young Ghanaians to have a sit-down and a one-on-one discussion with the presidential candidates of the Convention People's Party, the great CPP, Ivor Kwabena Greenstreet, to engage him on policies and plans for Ghanaian youth in relation to education, jobs, creative arts, culture, and technology.
What kind of music do you listen to?
I like Stone Boy a bit.
Okay.
His song, what is it? Higher, higher.
Go high. Yeah, Stone Boy? Yeah. Okay.
We'll be right back.
an election year again.
So you know how difficult it is to vote in other countries, right?
In other countries, people are not allowed to vote when they are 18.
But thankfully in Ghana, you just have to be 18 and you can vote. And that's so cool.
It is our time to vote.
And together with Muse Africa, we urge you to vote.
I urge you all to vote.
Remember, your vote is your right.
Your vote is your power.
Participate.
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 Participate. Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Choose or lose.
Participate is a project by Muse Africa in collaboration with Oxfam in Ghana, Friends of the Nation, and the Ray Media Group.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, can we get a round of applause for everybody who actually pledged? Now, I'd like to encourage you guys to pledge as well. It's really simple. We just need you to take a piece of paper and write, I pledge, all right? Hashtag Muse Participate and upload it on social media. Our Twitter handle is @Muse_Africa. That's for Twitter. On Instagram, it's Muse Africa, @Muse Africa. So go ahead and do that and put it up. We'd like to thank Oxfam in Ghana for supporting this, the Rave Media Group, BBG, and Impact Hub as well. We're about to take some final submissions. Kojo, what's on your mind?
Yes. I think basically what the political parties must do is not to promise us any new things, because whatever you want to do is already on paper. Everything you want to do is on paper. By 2025, we need to create about 300,000 jobs every year for the youth. You have the National Youth Policy. I'm sure most of us here have not read it, but there are priority areas for the National Youth Policy. That answers almost everything we are talking about. So about 11 priority areas, education, and all that, yeah. You understand. EL mentioned music. If you look at the global value of the creative arts industry, like $2,200 billion. Mm. Africa's stake is just about $59 billion. Mm. Per the KPMG report on the Ghanaian music industry, it's estimated that about 30,000 people are formally employed by the sector, but the figure is huge. If you are to implement the policies and the things that we have, instead of promising new things without going back to what is on paper, we are not going to achieve anything. The plans are there. And trust me, Ghana has some of the finest plans ever for energy, education, agri, everything. So let's implement what we have already. Stop promising. Think about how you are going to implement what is on paper and evaluate the gains we are making with time so that we can get Ghana to wherever we want to be. We need to be competitive globally, or we lose out in the market.
How awesome. One more submission on my left. Gentlemen.
I'm Mohammed Sharifdin Al-Hassan. I'm a policy advisor with the Ghana Youth Integrity Campaign as a young civil society platform that inspires change amongst our people and to throw out corruption amongst the young people. I've been listening, and for me, it's been profound to be part of any Ghanaian program of the sort. You would listen to very intelligent expositions, opinions that any other person should want to listen to. I was expecting to hear the things I consider to be profound from our politicians. Unfortunately, I didn't really get that. There was only one thing that was striking, and that's one of the things the CPP person said, which was self-determination and self-reliance. And that's the part I think that we have lost as a people, the sense of responsibility, seeing ourselves as Ghanaians and committing ourselves to what we ought to do as a people so we have a collective value. Policy, no. You can have fine policies, you can strive to enforce them. If you are not disciplined, which is manifesting responsibility, we are really going to lose out. We are chasing for resources. We are trying to build our egos. We are trying to build ourselves. All of it tells us that we are not responsible. We have corrupt leaders. It stems from irresponsibility. We support violent activities that are instigated by politicians as the young people. All of that is irresponsibility. But I want to hear and see in the next president of Ghana as what structures is going to put in place to make the Ghanaian feel Ghanaian. Awesome. The Ghanaian see a brother as a brother. Mm-hmm. And the Ghanaian build a collective value with the Ghanaian. And that, for me, is what we need as a people, and no rhetoric.
Very beautiful, right, sir. Thank you very much. Akosia, I think you want to have a word with the politicians again.
I think we should take final comments from our politicians.
Thank you very much once again. And I must admit, I have been so much inspired by whatever interactions and discussions we've had here. I have been convinced that, indeed, Ghana has the brains to move Ghana forward. And as a party, would play so much attention, pay so much attention to all what has been discussed here, from education to creative industry to entrepreneurship and everything. And I want to add a bit on the education aspect, and I want to link it up to the creative industry. And I am sitting on behalf of a presidential candidate who believes that even in education, we can use our creative industry to empower Ghanaians to educate them better through our film writers, through our music writers, by investing so much into the institutions like NAFTI and making film writers realize that we need to create a story that represents us as Ghanaians, stories that would inspire us to develop the best for our country. And of course, we are going to do that, and it's not just a rhetoric. And I want to end by challenging the youth to be part of the political process. If you are familiar with the United States of America, most people credit the activities of the success of America now to the baby boomer generation and what they had done to contribute to the development of America during the youthful age. As millennials, let's see ourselves as the baby boomer generation for Ghana and make sure Ghana gets to where it deserves to be. And I want to end by a quotation of Kwame Nkrumah, who said that, "Seek ye political power first, and all other things shall be added unto you." And if you want economic power, let's participate in political activities. Go out there and vote, and make sure that you choose the right leaders in Ghana.
All right, that's here for me.
Well, thank you. The MPP party always steals ideas.
Uh-huh.
They've been stealing our ideas over the years, but this era we won't allow them. You know, we are saying that we are giving power back to the ordinary person who votes. Now, let's talk about corruption. Corruption is killing the state. We lose millions of dollars annually.
Okay.
So PPP government is offering a decoupling of the Attorney General's department from the Minister of Justice, so that Attorney General will be able to prosecute government appointees who are corrupt.
Okay. So what are you going to do different? You have 15 seconds left. Thank you. 15 seconds left. Just end on that note for us.
In 15 seconds.
Yes, in 15
seconds. We are providing jobs for the people.
Powerful.
We are giving quality education holistically, where by the time a person graduates from the SS level, he's employable.
Okay.
By making sure we add technical training, vocational training, and skills training to it. And then,
finally,
the person out there, we are telling you that, let me repeat it, we are giving you back your power.
All right.
That you invest into the PPP presidential candidate.
Thank you. He speaks powerfully, and as he was speaking, he was laughing. So I want to know what he has to say in a minute.
Thank you very much. Let's talk about Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo. We are talking about a leader who literally walks his talk, talking about education. He has mentored some of the prominent lawyers in this country. We are talking about creation of jobs and employment. As my friend in the suit, was complaining about, Nanadu is saying that one district, one factory. Even the atmosphere has already determined my powerful line, which is hope and change.
Powerful. Thank you. Thank
hope
you.
And change.
All right.
Big question still remains. Are we convinced? Are we going to vote? Are we going to pledge to vote in December 2016? Let's hear from our panelists finally. Yeah, let's take it from your end first off. Are you convinced? What do you think? What's running through your head? Real short.
Well, as for the matter of being convinced, it might take a while for me to choose what I want to do. I'm still going to vote, and I'm going to encourage everybody out there who has a mandate to vote to go out there and make sure that your voice is heard. On that note, I'd like to say two things. There's not going to be any of the plans that we're making manifested if we don't have a peaceful election. So I'm going to say to everybody out there once again that the voice is yours. You go out there and you make the decision, and let's make sure that as Ghanaians we exercise that kind of humility that we are raised with, and that is inculcated into our culture, and we make sure that at the end of it all we give respect to whoever the people have chosen and work towards achieving all these things.
Jemila, what about you?
Well, I think that we've heard still a lot of rhetoric, so I'm not totally convinced either. But I think I'm not going to address the politicians. I'm going to address the young people. Don't feel like what you do doesn't matter, right? At the end of the day, this country, you make up the majority. That's the reality. And I think a lot of what has gone on is because a lot of politicians or so-called leaders
think that they know how we're going to react to things. So please ask the questions and don't just go for face value. Think about your own future and those of the people around you and vote.
Let's not be ignorant. Very important message. Mr. Derry, a businessman, give us some hope. What's running through your head?
A lot. And so I'm going to vote, and I'll encourage every young person who has the right or the mandate to vote or to register, or go and check that he or she is registered and get them going vote. Seek more or less knowledge for you to be able to understand what you really want for your country. And also you have to think about the future. I think we need to cut out the kind of conversation we are having around our politics. There's so much. I see WhatsApp today and I see a picture of, no, we are even more or less, I see more as blasphemous to politics, where you're putting ladies and their behinds on the picture and putting targeted political, you know, colors and saying which one will you vote for. We need to elevate the conversation. And that elevation can be done by us, you know, and
power.
Let a politician thrive on your dreams. Don't thrive on their dreams, because they don't think well about you. Thrive on your dreams, you know. So that's what I would say. Go out there and vote, and then self-determine your own path.
Awesome stuff. Generally, I say one thing you say is think far, think long term. Yeah. All right, beautifully said. Could we get some people to pledge right now?
Yeah.
Some people in the crowd.
We actually want people
who
to pledge.
Who among you can say, yes, I am going to vote?
Man. This is your country. Okay,
I will ask
okay.
Who you're going to vote for.
We've got three people. You're going to vote. All right, please, an applause for them. Thank you. So three people, it means you need to do more convincing. And on this side, who's going to pledge? All right, awesome. All of them. Kojo, you're going to vote. All right. Oh, nice.
All right, guys, we'd like to say thank you for watching Muse Participates. This is the very first edition. It's been great, if you ask me.
Yes.
Do keep in mind that this was brought to you in association with Oxfam in Ghana, the BBG Group, Rave Media, and Impact Hub. Keep in mind, you can always be part of this. The hashtag is Muse Participate. So write it on a piece of paper, I pledge, hashtag Muse Participate, and upload it on Instagram as @MuseAfrica and on Twitter as @Muse_Africa. To end this, I think we're going to take a group a group photo, a group selfie, just to show unity.
So peace. Please, everyone,
very
join
important.
Us up
so let's
here.
Do this real
let's
quick.
Take a group picture. But an applause for you.
Yes.
Thank you so much for this. Thanks.